So I'm currently a product manager at Squarespace in New York City, manage our user-facing analytics platform. So what Squarespace is we help you make really beautiful, elegant websites really easily. And so some of our customers are things like Pixar.com, Chance the Rapper, Egg Shop. So we have an interesting monopoly on the New York City high-end restaurants. So if you go to a high-end restaurant in New York City, chances are their website's on Squarespace. We also have Falconry's in the UK. Virgin Orbit is also on Squarespace. And my favorite is Elon Musk's The Boring Company. They just sold out of like 15,000 flamethrowers. So they built their website on Squarespace, and their commerce store is also on Squarespace. So what I manage is the user-facing analytics product. And so that's what all of our millions of websites and e-commerce stores use to make better decisions about their online business with analytics. Cool. So before Squarespace, I was in San Francisco. I'm originally from the Bay Area. So I started there called Automatic, and Automatic was in the Internet of Things space. So we made car hardware and software. So the car hardware basically plugged into the OBD2 port of every vehicle driven in the US after 1996, and we connected it via Bluetooth to your smartphone to tell you really interesting insights about fuel efficiency and vehicle health. And prior to product, I was a early business hire at Automatic, so happy to talk about the transition there. But again, we were kind of 15 people in a hallway similar to this size. And then we grew to 100 people. It was kind of a roller coaster. We went through two layoffs and eventually were acquired. So again, happy to talk about that. And then before being in tech, I was an investment banker. So worked on tech mergers and acquisitions. So kind of went from the super high level finance side of things all the way to the product side. Like I said, at Automatic, it was kind of a roller coaster. There, I primarily worked on 0 to 1 products. So 0 to 1 products are products that haven't existed in the past, and maybe they're new business lines, new product lines. So that's pretty different from working on one of the end products, which I do at Squarespace. And so when I got there, the analytics product existed in kind of a baseline 1.0 form, and my job was to take it to head. So the common thread through with my product experiences have been data products, and so data products to help people make better decisions about various aspects of their life. Save money, save time, be successful. So at Automatic, that was decisions all around driver behavior, fuel efficiency, vehicle maintenance, car health. And at Squarespace, it's your online presence, your online business. So kind of a quick agenda for what I'm going to walk through, but again, please interrupt me in the middle or dig deeper on something. So we're going to go through quickly the product development cycle, or how I see it, do a case study on the Analytics 2.0 mobile apps that we launched recently, summarize lessons around user empathy and design sprints, and then conclude with kind of lessons from building the products. Any questions before we get started? This is not the topic game. Okay, so product development cycle. At a very high level, I like to think of it as learn, prioritize, build, launch, and measure. So various artifacts that come through each. So under learn, there's various tools that you can do to learn about a product problem. So user research, the most basic, talking to your users, market research, what's out in the market, what do people want, what are people looking for, analytics, if you have an existing product, how are people using it, what are the gaps. And then prioritize is once you have a list of problems that you could potentially solve, you probably need a product roadmap. So that's prioritizing the problems and making sure that your roadmap as a PM flows up to the company goals and drives company business metrics. And then the build phase, that kind of oversimplifies things, but certainly things you could do, design sprint, working towards an MVP, doing user testing on prototypes, dog booting, and private beta. So we're probably going to focus most on there. We're going to walk through the design sprint that we did for the analytics mobile app. And then launching, various ways to do that, A/B testing, beta, private beta, and then measuring. And then this whole cycle is kind of rinse and repeat. So let's put that into something concrete. So for the analytics mobile apps that we're setting out to build, the problem that we were trying to solve was how can we help our users make fast, data-driven decisions about their website and online business while on the go? Where we were at back in December 2016 was we had an existing iOS app, no Android app. It was in a very basic kind of 1.0 form. And we said, what are we going to do with this app? It's currently used by a good percentage of our users, but certainly not many, and we have a lot of feedback on what could be improved. So basically what happens is in 5 days, we had 2 user tested prototypes, and we knew exactly what to do next. And that was just in a week, but it did require an entire product team's time, so that's design, engineering, product, along with a few of our stakeholders' times. We got a lot done in just 5 days. So essentially what those 5 days looked like were on Monday, we mapped the customer journey and we picked a problem for this app to solve. On Tuesday, we sketched. On Wednesday, we decided which direction to go into. In our case, we had 2 kind of competing ideas and we decided to settle that with data and users rather than continue to internally debate. Thursday was prototyping and Friday was testing. So again, this all happens in 1 week. It's pretty fun. So we're going to walk through how we did the design. So day one is pick a problem and then map it out. So picking a problem is not like picking a specific solution. I think there's an important distinction between focusing on a problem versus focusing on a solution. And so these sprint questions are designed to illustrate the problem that you're trying to solve. So what we wanted to focus on was how can we add more metrics and richer granularity without cluttering the UI. So if you are familiar with Squarespace, our brand is very much in the minimalistic, elegant side of things. We enable you to build a really beautiful website. And so we didn't want to deliver an analytics experience that was counter to that. And we felt like what was out in the market was kind of very cluttered, complicated, hard to understand. And our customers are small, medium businesses. They're often one-person shops, one-person businesses. So we really want to create an easy way to make data-informed decisions without spending too much time. 2, our users are busy. How can we deliver it with the least amount of effort? And that's kind of where the user-centered mindset comes in, is we really care a lot about how much effort does it require people to actually understand something. We try to look at things from different lens. And then again, we're building a mobile app, so what's relevant in the mobile context in the on-the-go context? So we did a bunch of internal expert interviews on day one. Actually, that's a lie. They're supposed to do it on day one. We did it the week before because scheduling all of these types of people is near impossible in an afternoon. But we talked to a bunch of people, like stakeholders, anyone who would care about this, anyone who had expertise in our area. Particularly, I was a new PM, so I didn't have any of the institutional knowledge. And then we built a customer journey. I blurred out because the data isn't what's important. It's that it was very complicated, and then we simplified it down in that first day. And so we basically divided our users into segments, and one of them was the advanced analytics user segment, and the other one was the basic one. And that's kind of an oversimplification, but for our purposes, we decided to focus on the advanced analytics users. We figured, hey, if we cater to the advanced analytics use case, that'll solve the basic use case too. They're just more elementary users. So day two, we had a focus. Now it's time to sketch. And so what we started out the day with was a bunch of lightning demos of adjacent products or relevant products, so not necessarily competitors, but apps, other mobile apps that we found inspirational. And so as each member of the team demoed apps, we would jot down or sketch interesting interactions or things like that. And so that helps a lot in that you don't look at the actual solution, but because you have it in this more elementary format, you're focused just on kind of the structure and the idea behind it rather than the actual implementation. Yeah, hello.
Just curious about like the team that
yeah.
you're doing this with. Is it,
yeah.
is it the cross?
Yes, so the whole product team that would be working on this, that's me as the PM, designers, and engineers.
How many people?
It was about six or seven. So the book recommends about that size, and I will say that at the beginning of this, Squarespace wasn't really doing five-day design sprints, and so it actually took quite a bit of convincing and people's trust in me to get us to do five full days for designers and engineers. They were like, do you really need engineers to be right? They're like, that's really expensive. But if you if you saw what we did at the end of the week, it was such a good use of time. But we didn't have that practice before, so after this, the inspirational demos, we did this four-step sketch, and again, everyone sketches, including engineers, and I think that's really, really important, because the idea isn't that only designers sketch, or it's not meant to be an art piece. The point is that it's an interaction, it's a user flow, and everyone can draw boxes, basically. And my favorite exercise in the four-step sketch is the crazy eights. So Crazy Eights forces you to push past your first idea. So basically, you have an idea, you sketch it in 1/8 of a paper, and then you have 1 minute to do that. Your second minute, you're on your second variation. It has to be the same idea, slight variation to it. Third minute is your third sketch. And so you do this for 8 minutes and you end up with 8 different ideas. And you actually usually get much, much further along. Whereas if you didn't do that, you tend to be stuck on the first thing. So day three was, we had all of our sketches, it was time to decide, and so we put all of our sketches up on the whiteboard. We call it the art museum. So we basically went through each sketch and talked about it. We put the big themes and ideas on top, and then we put a bunch of concerns on the bottom. We did dot voting with stars, so it was really fun. You basically put stars and dots next to the interesting part. So again, this isn't about whose idea is best. We actually didn't write our names on the sketches. It was which of these components are particularly interesting that solve our split question. Storyboarding. So I think storyboarding is really important because this goes back to kind of building user-centered products. I think it's really easy to think about your product in isolation. So you think about, okay, how people are coming in and they're logging in and then they're doing X, Y, Z. But what are they doing before they log in? What are they doing before they open your app? What's going on in their life? What's their mood? Are they really stressed? Are they with other people? Are they by themselves? What is that context? And then also, what's the context after they leave your app? And what's their mood and emotions and reactions? So I think storyboarding really helps with that because you not only map out the user flow but the before and after as well. So for us, we had two competing directions, and again, what can happen is you can internally debate for a really long time, and then you eventually have to go to one, or you do this consensus-based decision-making, and it's this diluted version of both of them. But for us, we said, okay, we have these two directions, we're only in day three, so we haven't wasted that much time, but let's put this in front of users, prototype both, and see what happens. So day four is prototyping. We basically threw together really quick mocks of the two directions that we were going to. And what's interesting is that this was much before this week one of the whole project, but our end product actually looked fairly similar to what we prototyped. And then we did user testing with 5 users, and basically the entire team was involved in this too. Again, engineers, designers, and the whole product team. So after 5 user interviews, you can really see the themes emerge. The places that are really confusing, a lot of people will just stumble on that. The questions that are really easy or straightforward, everyone's going to breeze through. Usually have 1 or 2 outliers. But generally, if you get a good cross-section of 5 users, it's representative of your overall user set. our specific case, we have a lot of employees that have legitimate Squarespace websites and businesses, like side hustles. So kind of cheated and did that for this first week. And it's actually hard, I think it's hard to recruit with like in 3 days.
Oh, sure.
Because like on day one, you're defining your focus, and only then do you know which users you want to recruit. And so that's kind of why we used internal employees, because they were strong users already. But yeah, when, anytime we do user testing, it's like, pull this list of users, all these users, like, uses on this pricing plan, uses with this amount of traffic on our site, like, et cetera, and then we... So yeah, at the end, we had the user testing prototype, we had two, actually. We understood the problem that we were solving, so that was really important in that everybody on the team, designers and engineers included, knew why we were doing this project and what we were trying to solve. So if, you know, if they ran past their director of engineering, they're like, oh, how's this project going? Like, what are you guys focusing on? They knew how to answer that too. We knew what stakeholders wanted. They were involved from the very beginning. The team was bought into the direction. It wasn't one of those, like, we're finished with design, engineers see it for the first time. We settled internal debates with users. We had our assumptions challenged, which I'll talk about in a bit. And then most importantly, like, we knew exactly what to do next. So at the beginning of this week, it was very unclear, like, how are we going to build this totally new version of this mobile app? What are we going to do? What's the direction we're going to take? But at the end, we're like, okay, it's very clear. We need to do these follow-up things. We need to dig deeper into the detail screens, et cetera. So after the initial design sprint kickoff, so that was week one, we did a few more mini design sprints. And so the mini design sprints were shorter because we already knew the problem we were solving. We just needed to sketch the additional places that we needed more thought into. And then we quickly turned around and started doing user research Fridays. And so that was, we brought in users on specific Fridays, like every other Friday, and then we ran through our latest prototype. And so that was great for kind of setting us like an artificial deadline. We want to show a new prototype every single time we have a full user research.
So after that, like after the first week, was did you continue to iterate on both directions, or was one selecting?
So for some time we iterated on both, and then eventually it was clear that we could choose one.
Got it.
Yeah, so we didn't resolve it right in the first week.
Okay, nice.
And then at launch, so because we had gone through so many rounds of user research, there wasn't a lot of uncovered things that we saw in the private beta. So by the time we got to the private beta, that was like 1,000 users, 2,000 users, closed beta, and we found a few small confusing UX flows, but on the whole, it was pretty ironed out. So the feedback we got in the private beta was not, like, didn't change our direction. And then measuring. So after we launched, user feedback is still just as important. As we had event-triggered user feedback widgets in the app. So after you use the app for a while, we ask you, how's your experience so far? You can tell us. And we actually got a ton of user feedback through that, which is amazing. And each of those user feedbacks came in through email. And so I had the entire team on this distro. User feedback was just flowing in. If bugs were reported, like, these bugs were just filed and addressed even before I had a chance to go into Jira and do it. So it's great to have a team on.
How did you ask for
specifically? Yeah, it was, so if I have you, I'll show you in the, when I show a picture of the app, but it's basically a stack of cards, and so one card would pop up after you've used the app for a while and it said, how's your experience so far? And we had three emojis, so it was really easy to select, and then if you wanted to provide additional context in a freeform way, we let you do that. But it was important to be event triggered. So I think asking for feedback is asking time from your users, and a lot of people feel like that's really intrusive, so you gotta be nice and you gotta make it optional, basically. because a lot of people, the default way to like ask for a rating or ask for feedback is to like pop up something and interrupt your experience, and a lot of people do it right when you open the app for the first time, or like right when you open the app sometimes. And it's like, well, I came in here to do something, and now you're asking. Cool, and then one of the challenges was that actually basic analytics users are not a subset of advanced analytics users. We made that assumption, didn't think it was that bad of an assumption. We said, hey, design sprint, we gotta focus on one thing, can't cater to everyone. But then through user research, we found out that they actually have a very different use case. So low traffic sites versus high traffic sites. Just very different use case in terms of analytics. So we decided to do a dedicated user research round for those basic analytics users and ended up discovering lots of new insights that resulted in increasing some scope, but we thought it was worth it. Ended up being very, very much worth it. It's one of the most used features now in the app, but we almost didn't include it because we thought that advanced analytics users were kind of covered the use case. So lessons are like common flexibility. It's usually like frowned upon to increase scope midway through a project, but it's important if you learn something new to be able to do that. And then challenge your assumptions. It's really hard to, but always think of like, what are all the decisions that you're making? Are those assumptions actually? So this is what we came up with and what we launched with. So you can see it's kind of a long list of cards, and the cards give you a quick overview of that data type. And so to your question, the user feedback widget would appear as one of these cards. So it wasn't too intrusive. It wasn't like, take over your screen, do this now. You could do it, you could ignore it, and come back to it. And we had iOS and Android versions and iPad version. iPad is actually another thing that we added in later. We realized that 14% of the users were using this on iPad, and so we couldn't ignore that user base. So our app ended up getting really great reviews. And so to couch it in... I totally ruined the punchline. But basically, our old app had 3.5 stars. And our new app is 4.9 still, which is like crossing fingers, don't jinx it, but over 1,000 ratings, so we were really, really happy. And what was really, really awesome to hear is the sprint question that we had at the very beginning, like in week one, that we wanted to solve, came through in a lot of these app store reviews. It was like, you struck that balance between elegant and minimalistic design, but also giving us really rich insights. Also, and this is the Android version, but yeah, so this is my favorite review that came in. Yeah, just a one-liner. That's so great. Yeah, it's all pretty cool. So outcomes, business metrics. You know, every product needs to drive business metrics. So more users, our downloads quadruple. Deeper usage of analytics, because our hypothesis is if you use analytics on a regular basis and deeply, then you are more likely to be successful on our platform. So our sessions and our users tripled. Retention was much higher than the industry average. And then our various ways of assessing satisfaction in the app, like the App Store rating, the user feedback qualitatively that came in, and then the number of ratings too. So the app had been in the App Store, the 1.0 version, for many years. We only got 68 ratings total for the like 3 or 4 years that it was out. But in the 3 months that it launched in November last year, we got 1,200 ratings, we got so many more users, we got a great star average. So, and I attribute it to us being user-centered.
Did you articulate any of these goals? Like, I mean, it sounds like you started with a design challenge, not so much like a key, like one of these key indicators to judge whether you succeeded, or did you have these kind of in the back of your head as like the metrics you wanted to measure success
yes.
on?
Yes. So more users, deeper usage, and satisfied users was our success metrics. The only thing that we didn't know what we were going to measure was sessions per revenue. Because deeper usage can be measured in like various ways. But we knew we wanted to get our startup over. We wanted to get more reviews. Obviously, we wanted to get more downloads. So we look at retention as 1 day, 7 day, and 30 day retention. So retention is like, if you download the app on day one, what's the chance of you coming, or not the chance, but how many people come back on day 7, how many people come back on day 30, how many people come back 90 days later. So there's a steep drop off for mobile apps in like day 30 even, but actually most people who download an app like never open it or actually accept it. So we're looking at
and then what is the industry average right there?
20% for 7 day. You can, if you just Google like iOS business apps.
Well, are you comparing retention, you know, like to similar products or just like apps?
Yeah, so you can compare to apps in general, but we compare it to like business productivity apps. Because e-commerce, for example, is like much different consumer apps. Another outcome, which I think is important too, is team dynamics. And you know, you can ship a thing, and people can have hated working on it, but you still ship the thing, and you could have like drove business metrics, but people could have hated working with you. So I thought it was a great testament to the 5 day design sprint in that we were still talking about it at launch. And so like, these are two engineers that work on it, but they're like, yeah, that we really set us up for success throughout the. In summary, running design sprints effectively. So design sprints are great for tackling a hard problem that has some sort of risk associated with it. Like if you ship the wrong thing, then it's pretty bad for the company. And also if you have many stakeholders that have lots of different opinions. It's still up to the PM to do the pre-work and research. So even though it's like, oh, 5 days and you've got this thing already, I did a lot of work before that week to make that week. Focus on a dominant customer segment, but remember that's not everyone. Challenge your assumptions, right? Like advanced users is not necessarily the same use case as basic users, and then build in flexibility to your process. In terms of building user empathy with your users, or with your team, rather, I think it's really important to involve designers and engineers throughout the process, so not just at the like prototype phase, but during problem definition, sketching, user research. I think it's tempting to just say, oh, I'll conduct the user research, I'll give you the highlights later, or like I'll record the session, you can watch later. Nobody actually watches the video later. So make it during lunch, make it really easy to attend, make it snappy and efficient. Bring in users regularly. I think we're lucky at Squarespace where like I meet Squarespace users out in the wild, just like eating dinner and like just being out in New York. But even if you work at a startup, like bring in your users, whoever they are. If you have quarterly offsites, it's a great motivator to like bring a few in that have problems that are particularly topical to what you're trying to solve that quarter. Casual lunches, we do this thing at Squarespace called Lunch and Learn, where we invite users in to eat lunch with us and everyone has to eat lunch, so lots of engineers end up attending, and then we ask users questions. It's kind of an open forum. And then dog food. Everyone should be a user. You should be a user. And then if you're lucky enough to have employee users, which I think most people should, via the BC, talk to those regularly. Those people are really valuable for longitudinal studies. And so what you usually don't get is like you'll invite a user in and you never see them again, but longitudinal is like following the user through their life cycle. You could get to do that with an employee user because they're just done. So switching gears slightly to kind of lessons from building data products. So this is all around kind of like data and analytics. Analytics seems like cold, hard facts, like their numbers, their graphs, like how could you really be emotional about this? But people react really, really emotionally, particularly if it's data about their business and their livelihood. So you can use the emotional aspect for good, to like tell a story, convey a feeling, save your users from hard feelings, right? Like, you don't want to sugarcoat things, but you can, there are ways that you can make people not feel so negative. And so here are just like really small examples. Our default date range used to be today, and a lot of our users don't have a ton of traffic, and so what you would land on is this page. That's pretty depressing. You see this again and again a few times, you might not come back to the analytics. There's red, right? There's zero. So we end up switching our default date range to last 30 days, even though that's not like the most intuitive, right? Like, you'd think month to date, you know, year to date, but last 30 days ensured that you'd have at least 30 days of data. And then not too much red. So in our app, when we first designed it, we had the spark lines and the percentage change go as red or green. We saw a few with actual data, and it was like red all over the place. So again, like, these are small tweaks and small decisions, but it kind of really impacts your overall user experience. Abandoned cart. So we have abandoned cart analytics, and that's, you know, if you're an online store and people come to your site and they abandon your carts, we help you recover them. And if you look at this graph, this is one of the employee users. You look at abandoned, it's like $67,000 of revenue lost, just abandoned. And so it actually came up in every single commerce user interview, just unsolicited. Like, we were talking about something else, and they were like, oh, by the way, like, abandoned cart, every time I go there, I like almost have a heart attack because I look at all the revenue that I lost and don't know what to do about it. And what most people didn't know is, like, the industry average for abandoned cart on e-commerce is actually really high, 70%. And so this one, 89%, like, that's considerably worse, but we saw that most of our customers had around 70%, so they shouldn't necessarily feel that bad. So benchmarking is another way that you can couch things for users. So yeah, my goal was to enable our users to make data-informed decisions, and so how you display that data affects how people emotionally receive it. If they continue to get negative data, they'll feel bad, maybe they'll churn from your platform, things like that. So I think it's really important to consider the emotional side of analytics. And then the second thing is clean, thoughtful design allows the truly important insights to stand out. I think it's really easy to succumb to the temptation of, like, just give me all the data, because your users will probably ask for that in building a data product. It's like, just give me all the metrics, like, I don't care if you want, just give me all of it. But if you are really thoughtful about your design, I think it can help with people actually getting something out of it. So we think of kind of design, rich, simple, clutter versus clean, in terms of design for data. And so what we saw was a lot of third-party analytics providers had a lot of data, not to name who, but I mean, you know what I'm talking about. A lot of data, but it was really cluttered. It was hard to find what you were looking for. So what we saw was, like, people were saying it drowns you in raw, uninterpreted data in silos, and so every time you go to it, you have to, like, figure out where to go to get insights. On the flip side, our $1 version of our app, people were saying, elegant design, beautiful, minimalistic, it just doesn't give me enough data. Like, I find myself needing more. And so what we really tried to do with the 2.0 app is to strike that balance between rich and clean, which I think is hard. I mean, they sound like they're diametrically opposed. But this was one of my favorite quotes. The interface is so simple and minimal that the info you're looking at gets even more interesting. So people are paying more attention to the insights that they can get rather than trying to navigate finding your app. So that's kind of why we don't look at time spent within analytics as a metric, because I think that can be really so a few other user quotes. So, simple, elegant analytics app provides me with just the relevant data I need and nothing else. I think that's important. What you don't include is just as important as what you include. And then all with virtually no effort on my part. So we don't forced you to kind of design these really complex reports. A few ways to kind of strike that balance of essential complexity. Does the user have to study it or scan it repeatedly? And you can see this through user interviews. Does every metric or graph have flow and significance? So it's up to you what order you present things in, how you present them, how much you put in the overview versus not. Those are all decisions, whether or not you consider them. And then does it tell the full story? Usually people are looking at data to answer a question or prove a point. And they look at a thing, they'll usually have a follow-up question to that, and then they'll look at the data and have a follow-up question to that. So is the user able to drill down a few layers deep, a few lines deep? And then third, the data you already have, even if you're not a big company like Facebook or Google, can be used to deliver highly personalized experiences using machine learning. I have a whole separate talk on machine learning, but just a quick taste. So how I define machine learning is a field study that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed by observing data, and then they make a determination or a prediction about something in the world. And so I strongly believe that machine learning isn't just for the big tech companies that have a lot of data. They certainly have a strong advantage. But I think startups and smaller companies are probably sitting on a lot of data that's like domain specific, and that's really powerful. So you can use that to personalize user experiences. So at least Automattic and Squarespace, we've used machine learning to personalize experiences and help you make better decisions about things like fuel efficiency and your online presence. At Automattic, again, we're a small startup, but people were driving millions of miles, and so we had really interesting data for driver profiles. This is the last case study we'll walk through, and then open up for questions. But at Automattic, we were saying, we were trying to solve the problem, how should I improve my fuel efficiency based on my driving behavior? There's a lot of articles that you could write about here, like top 10 ways you can improve your fuel efficiency, but that has no bearing on how you actually drive, and people drive so differently. And some people are just like hypermilers, where they log all of their gas, and they're like, they do crazy things like tail the big pickup trucks to like reduce headwind. And then there's the other side, which like aggressive drivers like would never change their behavior, proud of being aggressive. So we were sitting on like a bunch of driver profiles, and we said, how can we individually recommend things to do for users? And so we used this machine learning technique called clustering, and we said, of all the millions of profiles that we have, divide them into 8 clusters. We're not going to tell the machine learning algorithm how to, but just divide it into 8, and we'll figure out what distinguishes them afterwards. So the question that really answers is, what are the biggest factors affecting fuel efficiency of drivers? And so for us, what we saw was aggression on highway, engagements on local roads, and the third factor was actually external factors, which surprised us. So weather, terrain, whether you're stuck in traffic a lot, had huge factors in affecting your fuel efficiency, and so it was like out of your control. So we named all the clusters as funny, interesting, memorable driver profiles. Your cabby, race car driver, peaceful stage, there's actually a surprising number of those. It was great. And what we came up with was we had what I like to call a vanity graph. Like, not a lot of people know how to interpret this graph, but it looks really cool. So we interpret it for you because we assign you to a driver persona and we tell you what that means. Maybe you're really aggressive on local roads, but you're really fuel efficient on the highway. And so we gave you those 3 factors and gave you toggles. And so your MPG, you could see exactly how much money you could save on gas, how much more you can improve your MPG if you change your behavior in certain ways.
Like, what's the ideal group to be in, just out of curiosity?
The ideal group? Peaceful faith. basically, not aggressive on the highway, not aggressive on local roads, and aggressive meaning you hard brake and hard accelerate a lot, and then live in a place that has straight roads, aka the countryside, and no traffic, and beautiful weather. and another interesting insight was we found a lot of Prius drivers drove their cars really aggressively. They were like, I'm in a Prius, I'm good to go, I'm green, I'm saving my income, all of that. But actually, your driver behavior affects your fuel efficiency a lot more than the car can do for you. So it's funny. So in summary, analytics is emotional. Really consider that. Strive for essential complexity, so that balance between rich insights and a clean interface. And then you can really personalize your user experiences with machine learning. And it's not just for the analytics. Cool. Thanks, Ellen. Happy to answer questions. Yeah.
Where did the decision to use the 5-day design sprint come from? Was that like a consensus that you had to arrive at with your team, or was that like sort of preordained in some sense?
Preordained. It was definitely not preordained, and it wasn't a practice that we did at Squarespace at all. So it took a lot of convincing the powers that be that was worth it. I had run design sprints in my last company, so it was like I knew it worked, I knew it was effective, I knew it was good for this specific problem. So once I convinced, you know, our directors that it was worth the time and worth the experience, we got to do it. And after the big success of that first design sprint, now we're like all the other product teams. Like there's, we have materials for it, design for first phase.
Cool. Thanks.
Yeah.
How often do you use those sprints now, and do you found something working better than in the book for you? Mm-hmm. Or did you change something?
Yeah, I definitely modified things.
Yeah.
And things. So the first time I ran it, I thought I could do more with less. So I was like, oh, day one, half a day instead of a full day. Try to cut corners. I would say day one is super important. You should spend a full day on that. But I definitely made a modification. It's like took out certain activities that ended up not being effective. There's one exercise they make you do how might we questions. And that was confusing to do along with the sprint question. It was much more straightforward to like, what is the one question we're trying to answer in this week? Everybody ends up knowing it, like it's very clear. You remember it a year later, like we did.
How often do you run?
Oh, how often? Whenever there's a good problem for it, so usually it's like big projects that are risky or unclear, you have lots of stakeholders, you want to get their buy-in, you want to demonstrate progress early on, there's high risk for like lots of internal debate that'll drag on. So like an undefined project, it really varies for us.
How did you arrive at that one question that you were going to answer? Did you use any specific methods for synthesizing the research and things like that?
Yeah, we went through a few brainstorming exercises where what is the goal, what are our long-term goals for the product area? What's kind of the riskiest part of this project? So there's always like the more straightforward, like we have to have settings, we have to have blah, but if there's something more risky, like should we do push notifications or not? Like that's a huge amount of engineering work, but like we're not sure if there's user benefit there. We kind of gravitate towards those hard questions.
Was it a lot of just debating?
So the customer journey map helps. If you all agree on a long-term goal and then you agree on the customer map. So if you saw we had like this really complex customer graph and then we simplified it, it was easy to be like, we're going to focus on this customer segment, and then within that customer segment, what are the actions that we should focus on? So the customer journey helps. Like, if everyone agrees on that map, then it's like, okay, point up.